down when they first got there. And they hung a cluster of grapes on a pole between two men. And by this time, the fruit had dried up because they had been spying out this land for 40 days. Amen, amen. So people with no vision see dry fruit as being no good. Amen. They see the dry fruit and don't think anything of it. But if you have vision, you see the dry fruit and realize that there's more where that came from. Amen. There's a tree down the hill that I can go and pick from today. I don't care if it's dried up right now. I know that there's some fresh fruit where I'm going. Amen. How many of you know it takes vision to look around you and see nothing and still trust God? Amen. Now watch this now, young folk. Look around you at all the saints that have been to Canaan. Amen. These people are the fruit of the promise. Now they're living testimonies that you can conquer Canaan. Amen. If you don't have vision, what you see is a bunch of old people that don't know nothing. But if you have vision, you see the fruit of the land. And you say, how can I get to where you've been? Amen. How can I become like you are? Can you tell me how to be successful in life? Amen. And I got to ask you this question. Since we're talking about vision, what is your vision for yourself? Amen. God told Habakkuk to record the vision or write the vision and make it plain. And so what I'm encouraging you all to start doing is writing down your hopes and your dreams. Amen. Tell God what you aspire to be. And I guarantee you, when you start to hand it over to Him, hallelujah, God will start to speak and give direction in your life. Hallelujah. Secondly, they had a different spirit because they had confidence in God. Look at verse 33. Amen. In chapter 13, it says, there we also saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, a part of the Nephilim, and we became like grasshoppers in our own sight. So we were in their sight. Amen. Everything that the ten described was physical in nature. Amen. Because their confidence was in their own ability. Amen. And not in God's ability. Amen. 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 We have to stop limiting ourselves based on what we see. Because what you see and what God sees are two totally different things. Now watch this. These brothers had to have low self-esteem because they called themselves grasshoppers. And then they automatically assumed that the enemy saw them as grasshoppers when they had been hiding for 40 days. How in the world can the enemy say that you're a grasshopper if he's never seen you? We got to get past low self-esteem, low self-image, and start walking in what God has called us to walk in. Amen. But when you think like Joshua and Caleb, it doesn't matter what somebody else thinks about you because your confidence is in God. Amen. Joshua and Caleb were fed up with low expectations. Amen. They were fed up with folks putting God in a box, saying what God couldn't do. Amen. And somebody who has confidence in God walks by faith and not by sight. Amen. Because I know that there's some among you right now that see death and destruction and depravity and licentiousness all around you, but you refuse to be deterred. Hallelujah. Because you recognize God as being a God that can do the impossible. Amen. Now they have vision. They had confidence in themselves, but they also had confidence. They had confidence in God, but they also had confidence in themselves because of their confidence in God. Y'all stay with me now. I see some folk yawning. I'm almost finished. Hallelujah. Now, Joshua and Caleb didn't have confidence in their own physical abilities. What they were confident in was that God would work through them to accomplish His will. And in Numbers 14, 8, and 9, Caleb and Joshua got to the point where they tore their clothes and they were so exasperated with the people. And the reason for that is that they kept trying to tell the people that if we go up to Canaan, if we go up just as God said we should, He's going to give them into our hands. Their protection is no longer with it. Amen. And so as you enter into stages of life and different kingdoms in your life, you have to understand that God is with you every step of the way. Amen. Because God placed in you, I'm talking to you young folk, you don't know this yet, but God placed in you a supernatural power. Got quiet. The Bible says that we're able to do, or God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all we can ask or think, according to his power that works within us. So there's a supernatural power that's in you. Hallelujah. Because he said in Jeremiah, I knew you before I formed you in your mother's womb. I created you with purpose. And not only did he create you with purpose, he equipped you to carry out that purpose. Amen. God gave you power for the purpose. Amen. But see, this is the good part now, because this is the part that a lot of folk leave out. In order to access the power, you got to know Jesus. Hallelujah. You need Jesus to access the power, because you can't turn on the power until the Holy Ghost says so, and you can't get to the Holy Ghost until you cultivate a relationship with Jesus. And you're never too young to have a relationship with Christ. Now, I told you this thing had a dual message. The first part was that the report of the many contradicted the report of the few. The second part of that message is that you have to go get what God has for you. Hallelujah. Do you not know that there are dire consequences for giving up on an opportunity that God places right before you? Hallelujah. Look at Numbers 14. Let me look at verse 22 and 23. It says, this is God talking to Moses saying, surely all the men who've seen my glory and my signs which I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness yet have put me to the test these 10 times and have not listened to my voice shall by no means see the land which I swore to their fathers, nor shall any of those who spurned me see. They had the fruit. They saw the land flowed with milk and honey. But they had a flaw. They didn't want to do the work necessary to secure the land. And this is why they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, because God promised them victory and they spurned him. They turned their back on him and they said, I don't care what you say, God, you can't deliver us to victory. They forgot that this was the same God that says, stand still and I'll fight your battle. Amen. Amen. And in Numbers 14 and 40, they got to the point where they realized that they had sinned. It is sinful to disregard your potential. Amen. It is sinful not to conquer your own kingdom. Because all of us have a promised land. Hallelujah. All we have to do is trust God that he's going to be with us as we enter into it. Amen. So I came today, young people, to tell you that when God places Canaan in front of you, you have to conquer it. Otherwise, you end up wandering all your life trying to find yourself. Amen. And there's no need to fear. Because it's not by your own power that you conquer anything. But it's by the Spirit of God that you're able to conquer your own Canaan. Amen. Anybody, are y'all feeling me this morning? Hallelujah. Let me close this thing out, because I see three folk in the back sleeping. Let me close this thing out. And I always close with our master, our Savior, the one who gives us the ability to conquer the Canaans in our life. Now, I talked all morning about achieving the impossible. Jesus was a master at achieving the impossible and beating the odds. So rather than believe the report of the team, I'm going to believe the report of Jesus. Can I talk to you this morning about whose report I'm believing? Amen, amen. Two fish and five loaves was not a mission impossible for Jesus. Hallelujah. Young people, listen to me now. Just like Adidas, to Jesus, impossible was nothing. Hallelujah. So, rather than Jesus seeing this as a mission impossible, this was an opportunity for God to show his power.
Hallelujah.
Jesus encountered a man born blind. And the disciples said, well, Jesus, who sinned? His mother or his father? Jesus said, you know what? You're worried about the wrong thing. Because look here, my God, let me tell you something. My God is all power. You worried about the wrong thing. Don't worry about drama. Don't worry about pain. Look here. This is an opportunity for me to glorify God. Hallelujah. Now, here's another report that looked impossible. Jesus was beaten on his way to Calvary. But check this out. Now, this wasn't a victory for the enemy. Hallelujah. It was just a fulfillment of prophecy. Hallelujah. Jesus was lied on. But this wasn't a victory for the enemy. It was a testament to his discipline. Because Jesus told Pilate, I could call down 12 legions of angels. That's about 24,000 angels. I could call down and wipe every one of you out. But I'm not going to do that. Hallelujah. Jesus went to Calvary in an impossible situation. The cross was rugged and sturdy. The nails were sharp. Hallelujah. And his tomb was freshly healed. But can I tell you something? God was watching the whole thing. Hallelujah. And the cross could not hold him. The tomb tried to hold him. Oh God, I feel that wheel turning. The tomb tried to hold him. But after 3 days, the tomb had to spit him out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And after 3 days, every knee had to bow. Hallelujah. After 3 days, all power in heaven and in earth was given unto him. Jesus was able to look back at the grave and say, oh grave, where is your victory? Hallelujah. Oh death, where is your sting? Hallelujah. Now right now, I came to tell you today that Jesus is getting ready to do the impossible again. Hallelujah. Because when you look at the young folks, and I know you want to quit on them. I know you want to give up on them. I know you want to throw them all to the side and say they're no good. But Jesus says he's getting ready to raise up this generation. This like he went to the tomb and said, Lazarus, he's getting ready to raise up this generation. Just like he went to Jairus' house and told that little girl, I think that roommate, get up, little girl. That laugh is downstairs, but they don't know. This is not a laughing matter. I am the son of God. Hallelujah. Just like he called the widow on the way to the cemetery and touched that coffin and said, boy, you better get up. I've got purpose for you. I've got stuff for you to do that you haven't done yet. Get up out of that coffin, boy, and support your mama, boy. Because see, the world thinks it's impossible to bring you back on the brink of death. Hallelujah. But I've got a different report. Hallelujah. I'm not one of the 10. I'm one of the 2. And Jesus told me to tell you that there are some Joshua and some Caleb right up in this house, right up here in the temple at this time. Hallelujah. And for that week, I said, for that week, somebody ought to say thank you. If I was in France, I'd say, merci beaucoup. But because I'm right here, because I'm in Mobile, Alabama, and Bethel, A.M.E. time, I tell the Lord, thank you for my sin. Thank you for these young folks over here that are going to do your will. Thank you for the pastor that's going to always shepherd the flock. Thank you for all the men and women of God sitting around and that's going to sow into the life. Hallelujah. Now, young folks, y'all look simple, but let me tell you something. God's got work for you to do. Just get right up in this pulpit today. I've seen some young folk that's going to be preaching the word of God right here in Bethel in this pulpit today. Now you might not see it right now because Lil Wayne told you can do something else. You might not see it right now because Jesus told you to go tell no, and he didn't tell you that he should be locked up with all his homeboys too, because if they doing 30 years and he's still out, somebody's snitching. Oh, y'all, let's listen now. Listen, y'all listen to all those lies. Because right here in Bethel, there's some Joshua's and there's some Caleb's that look out and see nothing but know that God is going to do something. Right here in Bethel. And you just don't know how. how long this word has been marinating in me. The Lord sent me this word in my sleep one night and said, this is for God. How many of you believe that today? That the report that you've been given is a false report. Hallelujah. You better listen to the Lord. Don't believe the report of the men. Hallelujah. They say that, you know, if everybody's saying the same thing, they can't be lying. Well, yes, they can.